And we're live, I think.
Hey, everybody. So I was having a disagreement with Filthy. Well, more specifically, I have a disagreement with him over Strauss Howe generational theory. And I say I have a disagreement with him. I mean, I really haven't made that big of a deal about it. In fact, I only mentioned it the first time like a few days ago. But, since most other debates on YouTube are or just turn into complete shitstorms, I figured it would be interesting to have a debate like this because the people in our audience, we're both people who, according to both of our audiences, are not complete spurgs.
Which is ironic because I actually am Spurg. Does that work?
I don't know, but I had 3 points of contention mainly, and from least important to most important, anything that you want to say or.
Yeah, I think I should at least clarify one thing that. I mean, it goes without saying that this is not the end all be all understanding of how history works. There's a lot more nuance to it, and obviously it's a lot more mechanical. Like you really like open it up and you're gonna find that things are just a lot more complex than this. Than just this happened because it's a third turning, or this happened because this person was born in this generation. Obviously, each turning is gonna have different individuals, actors, results, all that's arguing is that these things conform to certain very broad patterns, and that these patterns are fairly consistent throughout history. Furthermore, like this is, I don't th even think it's fact. However, I just think that it's a theory with a lot of merit, just based on historical, with a lot of explanatory power towards basically the previous 500 plus years of history.
All right, well, that sort of goes into my first problem with it, and that's that it presents itself as a scientific theory, yet there are a lot of points where it predicts itself, it cherry picks pieces of information, and it seems really more subject to opinion, and I'll give you a few good examples. The very first cycle documented by William Strauss and Neil Howe in their theory was the Reformation Seculum, which was only two generations, a hero and an archetype, the Arthurian generation from 1433 to 1460, and the humanist generation from 1461 to 1482. Aren't there supposed to be four turnings, yet here there's only two, and it lasts longer than the last few turnings have. This turning in effect since 1943, and the previous turning, the millennial seculum, only lasting 74 years in total.
Well, the current, I'm sorry, you were finished?
Oh, that was my point, but I guess I could also add that the Great Power Seculum, 3 seculums again, ago, according to the theory, they're straight up, they skip the third one. They just don't note a third generation. There's the Transcendental Generation, there's the Gilded Generation. They skip one and go straight to the Progressive Generation. So that's my point, is that it's proposed as if it's a scientific theory, walks all over itself, and doesn't, it's very inconsistent with its message.
All right, so my first response is that, well, that's a lot of examples you provided. I'll try to explain them as best as I can. So, with the first seculum, you refer to, I have to have this information in front of me. Give me a minute here. So with
yeah,
regards,
I had to take notes before saying all this.
Right. Yeah. So with regards to the late medieval seculum, the Reformation seculum, I believe you called it, from 1435 to 1497.
Right.
I believe the difficulty in there is not really from cherry-picked information, but more so much as, I guess you could say, a lack of information.
What I mean by cherry-picking was not that they're cherry-picking data in this instance. It's that the theory proposes that they're supposed to be four generations in each cycle, yet they modified it here for no given reason to just be two. And the only two generations they gave were a heroic and an archetype, so they skipped the first and the second.
I think the simple answer is that there's not enough information on the respective prophet or nomad generations. That is to say, for my audience, the screw up and the what are they called? Blanking on the name here. The screw up and the yeah, basically, I don't think there's enough information on the previous two generations. So I think that's why it skipped. I don't think they've completely ignored it so much as there's not enough information about what happened before in detail to possibly correlate. But, so it doesn't really start. It doesn't really stop at the first and second turning of that area. Like that happened. There's just not enough information to go on. I don't know this for sure. So to be fair, You could probably call me out for special pleading, but that's just my understanding.
Problem with that, though, is that the Great Power Seculum from 1792 to 1859, they skip a generation, and it's the hero, the third one. So they know enough about the first, second, and fourth, but they skip the third.
That's a thing. That's a very that's a Civil War seculum, which is extremely interesting in one very specific way. I mean, the explanation that Strauss and Howe give is that in the Civil War seculum, you have the worst traits of some of the archetypes, which is to say that the adult generations and like the worst aspects about them, the progressives and the gilded, that they just really came to their own, and this greatly accelerated the progress of the turnings. And you had the result of when the Civil War fourth turning would take place over like 5 years. It would start from the inauguration of Abraham Lincoln all the way to Lincoln's assassination. And this is also why, like, they explained that the Civil War was just so brutal, because you have so much of what is supposed to take place over 20 years compressed into a 5-year time span. And when you have that compressed into 5 years, you don't really have a generational archetype that rises into prominence, since enough people couldn't possibly be born in 5 years. So that's why there's no hero generation or no civic generation in the Civil War seculum.
Well, there is an archetype generation, but also the gilded generations 1822 to 1842 and the progressives 1843 to 1859. So they were raised and grew up before the Civil War. That you're saying that was William Strauss and Neil Howe's explanation. So it seems, if that's the case, they just may not have a very solid grasp on history.
It's hard to not say.
Not to be insulting. I mean, I'm not trying to insult them. It's just that's a very ahistorical claim, and response to just straight up skipping a generation. Well, if that was the case, why wouldn't they just make one generation? Why would they separate the gilded from the progressives, even if that was the case?
I don't think
why
I
are they?
I don't know if I could give an answer without repeating myself.
Basically, my first point of disagreement with the theory. Anything else to say on that, or?
Well, you did point out the millennial seculum, which is the one we're currently going through.
My second point, addressed this before I got into my first one. It's that these seculums, they seem to be very subjective. Finds a seculum is incredibly subjective. A good example of which would be the silent generation as an archetype, which is the generation that fought in World War II, 1925 to 1942.
Just a quick clarification. The silent generation, while there might have been some individuals who lied about their age, the bulk of the fighters would have been the GI generation or greatest generation, the hero generation from born in 1901 and 1924.
That wasn't my point, but that's an interesting thing to note as well. My point, though, was that if you're living in the United States, or you, that there can be a greater good, which there can't be. Literally, there can't be, because in order to initiate force in a way that benefits somebody, you have to disadvantage somebody else in the process. But I digress. I mean, hundreds of millions of people died in that generation over basically power, and all the U.S. did was response, and then they installed the UN and Europe, and the allies in Europe installed the EU. And let's not forget what was going on in the Soviet Union at the time, which the Second World War did absolutely nothing to stop. In fact, it sort of exacerbated it.
It not only exacerbated it, it made it worse.
Well, that was my point. Just exacerbated the problems, because they had to use so much of their already scarce resources during the war. My point is that be seen as an archetype generation from a very specific point of view. If you come from a very specific background and you have a very specific political point of view. But objectively, that wasn't type generation, because what came out of that was not good. You had all these people dying and all of these incredibly tyrannical political organizations being formed out of it, and in response you got a generation you got the baby boomers. I don't think I need to go into detail how bad they are.
Oh god, you have you seen my videos? I do nothing except crap all over them. I regret nothing. Honestly, the Vietnam War should have gone on for longer. I support a new Vietnam War come 2050, just to cull the next baby boomers.
Do you have any like response to that?
Yeah, so your point was you don't like the idea that the GI generation would have been labeled as a hero generation?
That wasn't my point. My point is that the classifications for these generations and how they conform to the theory seems to be incredibly subjective.
I'm not sure. I'm not sure how.
I just gave an example. Objectively, what happened during the GI generation is hundreds of millions of people died, and these terrible political organizations were installed. And look at that from a very slanted political perspective, then the United States expanded its influence around the world and needed Axis powers.
Although there's a lot of popular history that would paint the conclusion of the World War II or the Great Power Seculum as a great victory. I've come to the conclusion that the whole struggle was just international authoritarianism versus national authoritarianism. And I said as much in my last video, in the what?
That's what I'm saying. It was just a tragedy all around. There wasn't really a winner objectively.
Yeah. So I don't think we can really make a moral judgment. I don't think we should take the information at least as a moral judgment in regards to their conclusions. Like what conclusions we draw from it. Obviously, the winners are going to be the ones who write the history books. So I think this is largely why people consider the World War II to be a great victory for freedom, even though probably would have been better off if the Axis won.
Then you, but then, wait, what?
Don't know. I'm just thinking. I'm just. That's terrible. I know,
That's too
but
edgy.
that's too edgy. But hear me out. I mean, the Axis powers, they were largely nationalist and they were largely kept to themselves. They didn't really have much
I
international
know, as a
ambition.
matter of fact, Hitler wouldn't have, because his view of socialism was that every country in the world had to be socialist in order for a socialist society to work. So he would have taken over Europe, then he probably would have gone to Africa with Japan, tried to take over Asia, which I seriously doubt that would have been successful because of China, but if Hitler would have got his way, the whole world would have been National Socialist.
Yeah, you're probably right. Yeah, there's no winning side here. But I mean,
It
it
does
could.
seem to be just based, it does seem to just be the history, the winners are writing the history books, because then you've got parliamentary generation in 15 from 1566 to 1587 being described as an archetype generation. The Arthurian generation, which I mentioned earlier, 1433 to 1460, as a heroic generation.
You do
In
realize
both of
that
those gen
those are not descriptors of like any sort. They're not applying any sort of allocates or moral judgments upon them. They're just the terms that they use to that
I
the.
know that's my point, is that Strauss Howe generational theory is trying to make an objective scientific judgment about the quality of life broadly for that period of time, hence the reason it's called the theory, the Strauss the generational theory.
My response would be that you shouldn't really take calling of the millennial generation, the GI generation, the Republican generation, or any of these others as hero generations to be any sort of moral judgment, but really just sort of how they'll be viewed come later. The GI generation nowadays you would see as, well, they're known as the greatest generation ever. I'm pretty sure you would go to, say, the 1790s or the 1800s, that the veterans of the Revolutionary War would have been seen as just like the greatest heroes this country has ever seen. And I'm sure that the Germans would have said the same thing about their soldiers had they won the World War II Seculum. It's not a moral judgment,
Exactly that.
it's just an observe. I think the hero moniker is just an observation about how popular culture is
I
going to see
know
them.
what I just said is that it's not a necessarily a moral judgment, but it's not objective either. You just you did that point for me
Yeah, pretty much. Like,
that
there's no, I don't think there's any disagreement here.
powers had won World War II, then the silent generation would have still been, if the theory had even been developed, they would have still been seen as an archetype generation.
Archetype? I don't think that's a term they use. You mean artist?
artist. Okay. I heard somewhere, I think I was reading off a different site probably than you.
Where did the archetype come from? I mean, all these generations are referred to as generational archetypes. So, I don't know.
Did your avatar come from?
Mine?
Another Spurg moment. I have one of those like every stream.
I mean, I can probably go over a story. I mean, there's details I'm going to omit, but this character in particular goes back like over 10 years. I've been drawing a web comic that none of you guys are ever going to see. Ever. And yeah, this is the main character. I know for
Anons. Hey Anons, you should get on that.
They'll probably find it after a few they'll probably find it fairly quickly. I know for a fact that one of my three readers actually watches my videos, so hi. But yeah, this character goes back a while.
And no one really cares. It just would be interesting to see. I presume you don't want to reveal it because it's got some fetish shit on it.
Oh, hell no. Hell no. In fact, it's completely tame. It's just autistic as hell.
No.
Also, let's just say that my art has only barely improved in the last 10 years. Something I'm not entirely proud of.
And even though in that one super, that super autistic drawing you made of my character, you made him look like a rat.
I swear, I traced him off of the face of a fox.
Looks like a rat. He's got those big long whiskers and he's got that round head. That's a rat. So are you done? Are we done with the second point?
I think we're done with the second point.
The point is that being that this is a scientific theory that proposes that you can predict a future pattern based off of the past, qualify Strauss-Howe generational theory as historicism. So, I'm not saying it's a Marxist doctrine, but the Marxian dialectic would be an example of a historicist doctrine, the idea that utilizing the Hegelian dialectic to try and predict an outcome for society based on historical patterns. I expressed my disagreements with historicism.
Yes, you have.
For
the sake of viewers, why don't you repeat your? Why don't you go over that real quick?
Problems with historicism laid out by Karl Popper, known as the poverty of historicism. And instead of just explaining it myself, I am going to explain it myself. But you should read this book if you want it in greater detail, because this book just basically kills the idea that is a legitimate science, and it lays out a few major points for how historicism can't be scientific. The first of which being that the description of an entire society, because the list of characteristics making up such a description are unlimited. There are a bunch of variables you will not be able to account for, and therefore trying to make a scientific hypothesis of the direction society will go is be done in good faith. Being that human history is a single unique event which doesn't necessarily imply anything, and otherwise is just the logical fallacy of induction, trying to insert things that aren't really there. Given related base material, piece of material. The third being that individual human action or reaction can never be predicted, and therefore neither can the future. And I think that's pretty self-explanatory.
Of course.
The fourth being that natural law, scientific or social, exclude possibilities, but it does not allow us to narrow down a range of possible outcomes. I mean, that's pretty self-explanatory too.
Yeah, I would think so.
Is that it's logically impossible to know the future course of history when it depends in part on knowing the future growth of scientific knowledge, which unless you are a mind reader or you can see the future, it wouldn't be possible to know that. What's going to come out or what we already have that's in development or how people are going to invest their money. It's just, it's a ridiculous thing to try and predict that. Those are the main points based on which historicism can't possibly be scientific. And since Strauss-Howe generational theory is a historicist doctrine, what are your thoughts on that?
My thoughts, I'm worried are going to come down to special pleading, but my immediate response is that it's going to... It can't predict the future. I mean, Strauss and Howe like stress very clearly in their book, The Fourth Turning in American Prophecy, and yes, you probably should check it out, that obviously you can't possibly predict the future. The book was written in 1995, so they couldn't imagine things like 9/11 or the 2008 financial crash.
But maybe they knew about 9/11 in advance.
If they knew about 9/11, that actually would be remarkable. They predicted that there would be an event roughly around 2005, which is why on Wikipedia you can probably see like a fourth turning current from 2005 to present, even though actually it would have started in 2008 with a financial crash. That's
interesting that they were that close. I mean, you could be farther off, but... But yeah. Still, all they were doing is theory and just making a broad claim, saying, oh, well, 3 years is close. That's not very specific, though, if you really think about it. Something that'll happen around 2005. It seems very vague.
Mm-hmm. That's true. Not going to deny and that.
And you just explained how you could interpret that as being, well, 9/11 happened, or you could interpret that as being the 2008 market crash. Both of them are generally around 2005, mm-hmm. and they impacted the world greatly.
Mm-hmm. I think one difference is like how the world might have reacted to 9/11 is a lot more interesting than 9/11 itself. Like one of the claims that they do make. What?
I get that.
Mm-hmm. So just for the viewer's sake, I'm going to explain this. So one aspect of the theory is that how time periods react to certain events in history is going to change depending on the turning. Like on the first turning, if 9/11 happened, it would have been a call for people to come together as a nation or as a society. If it happened during a third turning, it would just be a another example of society falling apart, which is kind of what happened. I mean, yeah, you had some unity after 9/11, but that quickly fell apart as the war in Iraq kind of fell into full swing. And in a fourth turning, if 9/11 happened, society would have mobilized to just go nuclear on Iraq and Afghanistan.
What about the Hindenburg disaster? That happened during the Silent Generation, which was a fourth turning, and no one reacted even remotely close to let's go to war or whatever.
I think that was because that was an accident. and not really a cause for anything. I mean, what would it have catalyzed? That we shouldn't use, or we shouldn't be flying a giant blimp full of helium or hydrogen.
Go to war with the sky.
Well, I think only I think even the state is not dumb enough to do that. But then again, you did have Emperor Caligula who went to war with the
Don't.
Atlantic Ocean.
Yeah, don't ever underestimate the stupidity of the state. I could very easily see, like if this theory was correct, that in response to the Hindenburg disaster, the state could say, "We're declaring war on helium."
Hydrogen. You know they probably would.
They both start with an H and we're the state, so they're the same thing to us.
Would certainly hope not. I'm pretty sure you have to have a special kind of state, like the Emperor Caligula's are kind of a special events in history, like catalyzing events onto themselves.
FDR was in office. I
Well,
mean, I could have seen that happening.
true, but unfortunately, he was a regeneracy event during a fourth turning, so yeah, make of that what you will. And we kind of went off topic, like severely, but that's fine.
I mean, my third point, which is my biggest disagreement with Strauss Howe, is pretty straightforward. It's a historicist scientific theory, and you can't, and historicism is an inherently invalid doctrine.
I'm just not 100% sure if you could really say the same because you have other historicist doctrines like Hegelian dialectics and more importantly Karl Marx's historical materialism, which argued that like they knew exactly what was going to happen to society. This was going to happen and
And
this was
it
going to
didn't
happen very
fucking happen.
specifically. What?
And they don't happen. So instead, they just they get like-minded people to infiltrate the government and then make those things happen. Like how he described the profit things becoming the market innovating and making things cheaper, but the prices still stayed high. That's what Marx predicted, and but that wouldn't happen if you didn't have all these minimum wage increases Marxist politicians advocate for. And it's funny because in the German ideology, Marx very specifically argued against social democratic reforms on that specific grounds that you can't reform a capitalist system, that'll just make it worse.
Yeah, can't say he's wrong.
His conclusion was different, but his premise and his argument was almost spot on. He almost got something right for once.
Well, all you have to do is just say democracy doesn't work and you can't fail. It's like trying to shoot a barn while inside it.
Fuck.
So to answer your question, I think the big problem with historicism is that it makes very specific predictions on how society would go, whereas the Strauss-Howe generational theory is, and perhaps this is special pleading, I fully admit to this, but it's a lot more vague. They can't predict what's going to happen. They actually argue in their book that it's not possible to predict the future unless you have magical powers that can't possibly exist in a rational universe. That we can't say like what events are going to happen, who's going to respond to where, how generational archetypes will operate very specifically. And obviously these things are
So,
extremely important, but you can at least predict the patterns that people are going to follow.
really just an unfalsifiable theory, then.
It probably is, yes.
It's so.
Actually,
I mean.
no, that's not quite true because in order because there is a certain levels of falsifiability, mainly if you have, for example,
That's
say
fair. It sort of their predictions fall into a very specific category. Like you can't just point to anything and claim that that would conform to their predictions, but yourself just touched upon it, that they're left almost intentionally vague to where 80% of things that happen at any given time could conform to the theory.
I think
my point is there are things that happen all the time in different areas of society and the world that could conform to any generation during any period of time. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of things that would represent a fourth turning happens generation X. If we're going to look at like the music and the arts, doesn't really specify what makes a generation.
I didn't catch that. What makes a generation what?
Generation any certain way, and that's sort of what makes it so. It gives it a hyperinflated explanatory power. I suppose that would be a more. It's not unfalsifiable, it just has more explanatory power than what is rational for what the theory is presenting.
I see. So you think it has too much explanatory power?
It's funny because Popper himself also touched upon that theories which have more explanatory power than what they're rationally capable of are generally theories, or there's something wrong with them.
Possibly.
What he said is that they're unfalsifiable, but we've already established that this isn't necessarily an unfalsifiable hypothesis, but the same rule applies here, that there's it's left intentionally vague so that there's more explanatory power than what's actually presented.
Mm-hmm. I should point out that, at least on the topic of falsifiability, because for a moment I did agree with you, but then it occurred to me, like, no, this is absolutely falsifiable. Say, for example, in 2030 to 2050, which is when the next first turning is predicted, that we go right back to essentially the 90s, a time when with low institutional trust but high individual enjoyment. And there's like cynicism in the air, distrust. People fall back into their own splinter groups and takes on the characteristics of a third turning.
Assuming that we're talking about one specific area, which is what I was talking about. If you the Strauss-Howe generational theory doesn't explicitly reference that it could be that it's a political movement. In fact, it's very specifically, it says it's for the broad area of society. It's talking about society. So I mean, you could have political sense, but you could also have that in an artistic sense, and it could conform to being a fourth turning as well.
Well, art and taste tends to also follow the turnings. I mean, not specifically, but I mean, like, what movies would be enjoyed during certain turnings might not be able to be made. Like, I touched on this in my
example of that. And a great example of that is that through which one?
I touched
Enlightenment. The Enlightenment generation. That's not talking about a political movement. That's merely talking about social attitudes and the arts. But that's a fourth turning. We have fourth turnings that society is just completely going to shit. Attitudes are terrible. Everybody hates one another. Pulp development is just,
I only caught every other word.
It's subjectively interpreted to be a good thing. That's because I'm stammering. I'm sort of starting to have mental exhaustion here.
I'm actually not sure
it's fine. We can. I'm starting to think faster than I'm talking, and that's what happens whenever that whenever that happens, I start stammering a lot.
Yeah, I was wondering if that was Discord, because it sounded like you were being cut off every other word.
And the recording, too.
Maybe. I don't know, my computer's pretty beefy. I think it can handle it. So could you...
Did you have anything?
Could you sum up what you said just before, because I only caught most of it.
About Strauss, how generational theory is another point, I suppose, is that something, a turning, seems to also itself be subjective. It could be a political movement. It could be the changings of social attitudes. While politics suck, you could have desirable political developments according to your own subjective opinion, while social attitudes suck and there's nothing really going on with art.
Well, I did give the I was going to go into my May 4th video on Star Wars and the Turnings, and that actually provides a pretty good example. Strauss and Howe actually used the example of Star Wars A New Hope, Episode 4, aka the original Star Wars, as an example of a movie that just makes absolutes, is like the kind of movie that would really appeal to a certain generation. You couldn't make A New Hope today, because the themes of mysticism triumphing over technology simply would it makes perfect sense to a more mystic, a less rational second turning, but to a fourth turning audience, it's not gonna go over all too well, which is exactly what happened with The Force Awakens.
Tried to make another New Hope, and that's what happened.
Yep.
Well, the problem with The Force Awakens wasn't necessarily its message, it's that they did it in the worst possible way. In A New Hope, wasn't even really, like, he wasn't really getting into his Jedi abilities at that time. But it was like towards the end, his training with Obi-Wan, and they didn't get into Luke being a Jedi until The Empire Strikes Back. But in The Force Awakens, character Rey has no training, and she's more powerful than
a freaking trained Jedi and dark side user, because she just closes her eyes.
I mean, a lot of people think that's the problem. I've seen that. You're not the first person to point that out to me, but think that could have worked, except they just made the movie about a Mary Sue, and that's why it didn't really work as well as it did. And don't tell me that Rey is not a Mary Sue. Rey is a Mary Sue.
I think by any objective standard of measurement, she's a Mary Sue. Let's see. She has this amazing power with no explanation or training. She just has it. The entire universe basically revolves around her. Like, you remember, what was it called? The Last Jedi. How basically the entire movie, or now first half of the movie, was like Snoke trying to just like, bring Rey to me. She's so important.
It's like a fan fiction. The only way that Rey could be any more of a Mary Sue is if she had rainbow colored Pegasus wings.
I'm pretty sure you've already inspired some DeviantArt entries right there.
From a Mary Sue meme. The Mary Sue had rainbow Pegasus wings, and it's completely freaking true, because there are so many Mary Sue characters that have something like that.
Oh, and by the way, in episode 9, she's, or not her, but Leia is supposed to have like insanely over the top force powers. It's bad enough that she can basically fly through space Mary Poppins style, but now she's apparently tearing down battleships from orbit.
is so insane. Did Luke even have that sort of power in the expanded universe?
Actually, yes. But the thing is, though, he became the most powerful Jedi ever in the expanded universe, like, ever. But it kind of makes sense because, one, we saw him, like, gain his power through the movies and raise a family, all sorts of really cool stuff. Like, I'm not too familiar with the expanded universe, it's just all I know, but yeah, that was a thing.
Alright, so do you have any more about Strauss Haugen? What?
You were extremely loud, just surprised me. I'm gonna have to
edit
that down if I can find it.
Any more about Strauss Haugen generational theory?
Yeah, I think the best I can say is that, yeah, the best you can say about it is that it is very vague, and thus it does provide perhaps too much explanatory power. That does make a lot of sense, and it's also, however, it does also have a very, I think, satisfactory set of possibilities that its vagueness also works in its favor, that if a new generation, if the new post Gen Z generation takes on characteristics of a cynical nomad generation or a very quiet and supportive artist generation, then you can probably disprove the Strauss-Haugen generational theory pretty easily. You can also probably just do that by having society make a deliberate effort to make sure that the generation after Gen Z is, you know, raised differently than the way baby boomers were.
Well, I mean, you can disprove it. You can point at the silent generation. Look how horrible that was.
How are they horrible?
So you basically had a worldwide market decline. You had millions. I got into how it's horrible already, but...
But they were kids at the time.
Right, I suppose.
Yeah, I mean, like, it's not their fault. I mean, you could probably blame... I would say it's the missionary generation's fault.
The GI generation came before...
Yeah, but they would have been young adults. They would have been either children or young adults at the time.
Let me look at my notes real quick. The GI generation was 1901 to 1924. So during World War II, they would have been early 30s.
They would have been the 30s. The youngest of their cohorts starting around World War II would have been 24.
They would have been like just barely old enough to sign up.
They would have been I think the appropriate age for signing up. You probably had some silent mixed in there, though. They were probably like too young, but for sure the ones signing up were, or being drafted, were bulk GI. I don't think that they were definitely not the cause of the Great Depression, though. They would have just been too young. They were kids at the time.
Yeah, I know. I'm just saying what's going on in society. You have the Great Depression. You have these tens, hundreds of millions of people dying. You have these all wars are unjustifiable, but you have these wars that are blatantly done in the name of power. Mm-hmm. Happens in the end is you get the baby boomers and you get these organizations installed which turn out to, even at the time, were pretty tyrannical, like the UN or the EU. So
my point is that
what about the silent generation makes it a artist generation?
The fact that let's see, you had Jimi Hendrix, you had the Beatles, you had, what's his name, Elvis Presley. Yeah, even Martin Luther King Jr. They were all about the people who resonated with the culture during the next seculum.
And that's what I'm talking about the cherry picking. Assholes who came out of there, too.
Of course, there's going to be assholes in every generation. Oh, except the asshole concentration is particularly high in the profit generation. I'm pretty sure, like, the problems we have with the baby boomers today would have been the same thing for the missionary generation, which, by the way, guess who are in their middle age and elderhood come the third turning and fourth turning of the great power seculum? The missionary generation, who are the same generational archetype as the baby boomers. Gee, I wonder if that's a coincidence.
Probably not.
No, of course not. It's the same crap throughout history. Guarantee you the transcendental generation were absolute assholes in their time, as were the Awakening, Puritan. Well, I mean, it's Puritan, so you can probably guess how terrible they were. Reformation and whoever it was that came before the Arthurian generation in the late medieval seculum.
But that's my point, though, is that it's just sort of picking and choosing parts that confirms and doesn't. There are artists that come out of every generation. There are assholes that come out of every generation, and there's a lot of them.
Mm-hmm. And of course, we're not discounting the individuality of every member of their generation. It's just that you're more. This is that they're more like more likely to be predisposed to certain actions and behaviors. I mean, then again, like, have you ever met a baby boomer who was not a narcissist?
Time pointing one out, but at the same time, we the third turning, the millennials. There's a lot of single mothers, and there's just a lot of rates that are not good. We're basically raising a generation of people who are just going to be like Ramsay from Game of Thrones.
I'm sorry, I don't watch Game of Thrones, so the reference is lost on me.
He is a self-centered psychopath who just does whatever he wants to anybody. He's like the only cool character on the show, and they killed him off, so I'm not interested anymore, because just all that's left is that overpowered dragon bitch, and it's just not interesting to watch now.
Yeah, that's that sounds like a kind of a problem. Although, you know what, I don't remember the exact details off the top of my head, but I remember Strauss and Howe actually giving examples of the very similar things were said about the GI generation during their time, that we were just raising a generation of entitled psychopaths.
Say the same thing about every generation. That's my point, is that nothing here is specific to any generation.
They do give examples of certain traits and characteristics played upon generation. Like, if you recall, Gen X was not meant to be like extreme. It was meant to be a pejorative, a generation of losers, a generation of nobodies, and that's conforming to the nomad archetype, that as a generation, yeah, they're put down. They can't live up to the whole thing's like they can't live up to the glorious legacy of the hero generation, who are just now entering elderhood at the time, and they're not as special or important as the prophets, who are now entering young adulthood. They're kind of just there.
I understand what Gen X is, like what it meant. I'd actually to recall if I've ever heard anyone call it Generation Extreme, and if they did, I would think they were stupid.
They're probably stupid, but if you recall, like in the 80s and late 90s, there was a lot of branding around X. Like, the X, you remember the XFL, the Extreme Football League? I don't know why I recall that one off the top of my head, but just...
And, for some reason, I like going on YouTube occasionally, and I watch commercial breaks from years ago people recorded, and just watch 90s commercials. Just, you don't even need to see the brand, just the attitude and everything. It has a very specific tone to everything. It's like everything is talking really fast and yelling, and they love the close-up camera, the wide-angle lens. They love it.
Don't they also love the Dutch angles?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, that's always a fun thing. And occasionally you'll get a.
It's more the wide-angle lens. I like just try that. Go. Look up like a commercial break from 1996 or something, and like I swear to God, if it's not every commercial, then like every third commercial will feature a wide angle lens.
I couldn't say if that's a characteristic of a third turning. Probably not. It's probably just the style at the time.
Well, that's what I mean. I mean, that wasn't just an offhand thing. I actually had a point with that. It's that these are stylistic things as well. There's more. I think it's more of a influence than it is, oh, it's this generation, so we got to do this.
Yeah, that seems about right. If I recall correctly, like there was a one example that they provided was that during the 50s and 60s, or very early 60s, that like it was found that the baby boomers were the first generation of kids ever who were a specific childhood marketing demographic.
Interesting. Yeah, I
Yeah.
didn't know that.
It was the first time ever that there was just that was a thing, apparently. Which kind of goes on to the point that they're trying to make about the generational archetypes that a prophet generation who are born after a crisis are going to be indulged as hell. And as a result, well, you end up with a bunch of raging narcissists as adults.
Yeah, well, that's it seems that's more of a prophecy than it is sort of a well, it's this generation, so it's got to be it's going to happen this certain way. It's well is indulgent then if there is a lot of indulgence and there is a lot of austerity then stands to reason that but the there's austerity, there's a lot of people getting rich all the time. And that's another problem with that is again that just goes there's to any generation.
Every generation is, well, they're going to have problems, but it's always specific problems, it seems.
It's the way you put it. Like these problems are more common. Again, that assumes a sort of as assumes a political opinion, as a specific point of view.
I don't think so. I mean, I like to know what political view is being assumed. I mean, there is kind of a theory that
Joking right now, I actually like I forgot what I said.
you said that it's describing certain political beliefs. And they actually do make that argument that
I
certain
locked up right
generations.
there. I don't even remember what just happened, like no joke.
Okay. Yeah, everything okay?
Everything's fine.
Okay, good. Yeah, so he does point out that certain generations are going to be more predisposed to, say, liberal or conservative ideas. Generally speaking, smaller government or bigger, or smaller government more collectivist, or smaller government, more individual, bigger government, more
Is that
collectivist
what I
ideas.
said? That people are going to develop political opinions, and that assumes a political opinion. What the fuck? Oh my God.
You said something about that, yeah. You'll be able to hear it in the recording if you listen back.
Okay. I'll listen back. I'd prefer not to reveal a lot about how my mind works on camera because. That's the one thing that I did Minsky that's valuable information. It's it's important that I know what I know, but you know something different. Me. That helps me for debates, that helps me for just about everything.
All right.
About it because it doesn't seem like we're really going anywhere.
No, not really. I think that's just about it.
I mean, that was good.
Yeah, it was interesting. Yeah, we explored some of these ideas at least. Just out of curiosity, have you read the book?
Which book? The Strauss Howe one?
Yes.
When we officially established that there was going to be a debate today, I picked it up and I read like 30 pages in, but I haven't been able to read the whole thing.
Oh yeah, read the whole thing. Like everything, it goes a bit deeper the further in you go. Even make some
I'll make sure to do that, and anyone who's interested in a specific critique of historicism, you should pick up Historicism by Karl Popper. Then more people need to read because it's not just Strauss Howe or Karl Marx. There's idea that's prevalent in society. You can predict the future by looking at the past. I suppose if we're going to talk about specific things like, oh, well, we're going to have we're going to have a lot of money and a lot of resources, so that's going to lead to something. That's fine, but individual development is different. Predict everything just based on that. You can predict very specific things, but that's not predicting the future. That's just taking something you already know and making a generalization.